I should make like an entire like thing. Okay, this is completely incredible. And I assume you'd assume this exact kind of thing is very common. This is by reading underscore life 2004, which means that she most likely is 14, and that is the prime age for excellent fan fiction. This is called Slytherin Princess, and I don't know why I haven't done a lot of Harry Potter before, because it's like the perfect well of like not. It's bad. It's bad. Like, the original, like, story isn't even that good. So, imagine the fan fiction for it. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Let's do it. Slytherin Princess. Characters, 1, Skylar Evergreen. 2, Draco and Andrew Malfoy. I don't know. 3, Harry Potter. 4, Ron Weasley. 5, Hermione. 6, Luna. And 7, Neville. More Chakarters that are my own. Skylar Evergreen, House Slytherin, hair color black. Height, this is the description of the story. Height, 5'3". Crush slash boyfriend, Andrew Malfoy. Oh, really? Oh, sorry. Friends, Harry, Ron, Blaze, Neville, and Cedric. I bet. Best friends, Weasley twins and Luna and Draco. Enemies, Ginny Weasley, Cho Chang. What did she even do? I don't even remember her in the books. Lavender, Pansy, Patil twins. What did they even do? It's so weird. Father, Joshua Evergreen. Mother, Callie Dumbledore Evergreen. Grandpa, Headmaster Dumbledore. That doesn't make sense because he's gay. Learn your canon. Older brother, Nathan Evergreen. Older sister, Cleo Evergreen. Hope you enjoy the book, Turtle. Smiley face, XD smiley face, XOXOX. Disclaimer, I don't own any of the original Harry Potter characters. They all belong to J.K. Rowling. 5 exclamation points. Let's get her done. I kinda can't wait. Without further ado, please, when I tell you to read, please do the thing that I tell you to do. Please do the thing. 1 second. Okay, the first chapter is called Diagon Alley, of course, and of course we begin with Skylar's point of view, because there's no way we could assume that from the writing. Wow, look at that beauty, I said while admiring the Nimbus 2000, all lowercase. It is, oh mum, can we get it? It doesn't even say mum, but they're British, so I just sort of assumed. Andrew said to his mother, Narcissa Malfoy. Good use of name. Now, children, it's only your first year. You aren't allowed to have a broom, Narcissa said. But you're a Slytherin. You should break the rules. My name is Skylar Evergreen. My father is Joshua Evergreen, and my mother is Callie Dumbledore Evergreen. That's not... You don't parenthesize the maiden name. If you have to, you hyphenated. You don't just slam it in there. Yes, that makes the headmaster of Hogwarts my grandfather. We are at Diagon Alley right now to get our supplies for our first year at Hogwarts. I was excited. Andrew was going into his second year. Isn't that your crush, I think? I don't remember. Draco, on the other hand, could care less about going to Hogwarts. I've been staying with the Malfoys for the weekend since Mother and Father have some important ministry work to deal with. Mother is an Auror, and Father is a governor alongside Lucius Malfoy. So, you're just pretty fancy princess lady, and you're going to Hogwarts, and you're gonna have the best time, and nothing's gonna go bad, and you're probably always going to be correct and moral in everything you do, and anyone who's your enemy is going to be evil and wrong in everything they do and think and say. We went into the last store of the day, the bookstore, my favorite one of all. After all the Quidditch supplies, of course, of course. Quidditch is so important, of course. Of course, we're not getting any descriptions of the environment, because why would we need that? We have movies. Now only buy what you need, Narcissa said. I frowned and headed to find my books for the year. After a while, Narcissa came over. You may buy 2 books of your choosing, darling. You are the only one who reads alongside Andrew, and, well, you've finished all the books in the library back home. This isn't your mother, this is just a person that you know. Why is she buying you books because you finished all the books in her library? She told me, and I hugged her. Oh, thank you, I said, and she kissed my forehead. They... Suddenly, this is like a far more intense relationship than I figured it was going to be. Or is she like a godmother, or what's up? After paying and leaving the store, ow, I said. I rubbed my head and picking up my bag of books. In front of me was a orange-haired girl. Oh, sorry, I said, and she stared at me. After a while of staring, I an excessive number of seconds, she gave me a death glare and walked away. The evil eye, a real spell. She later came back, but with 2 people along her side. Fred and George Weasley! Capitalized, of course. When they saw me, they smiled. Hello, little Skylar, they said together. That's what they sound like, combined. One of them is dead. I laughed and responded with, Hello, Freddy. Hello, Georgie. How are you today? They picked me up and twirled me around. I saw the orange-haired girl huff. Why did she return with these people? At all. It's a very strange... Is she the... She's orange-haired, so maybe she's Ginny? Is that Ginny? She's not going to school yet, because at the point at which Fred and George... were in school, and Harry was in year 1, which is where this is starting, because you're also in year 1 with Draco. Right? Ginny was, like, 9. Because she's, like, 3 or 4 years behind the cast, I think. I think? It has been a long time since I imbibed any Harry Potter. What is the... They put me back down and were about to say something when Draco came by. Everly. Everly. Mother is waiting for you. Let's go. He told me, I guess that's just a lie. He told me and grabbed my arm. I waved goodbye to them. What the bloody hell was that for, Draco Malfoy? I told him. I tickled my own heart, physically inside my chest. He didn't respond, only dragged me all the way back to where Narcissa stood waiting with Andrew. She smiled when she saw me. I respectfully smiled back. Now it's respectful. She kissed your forehead like 30 seconds ago. On our way home, I put a silent charm in the back of the car to yell at Draco. You can do silent magic and you're not even year 1? Isn't that like a thing that it's like advanced wizards can do this? Maybe. And it's like the thing you last learn? Uh-oh. That just gave me a huge red flag. I had to think about it for a second. Even though Andrew was there too. Draco Malfoy, answer me. What the bloody hell was that for back there in Diagon Alley? I told him angrily. All he did was ignore me. Comma splice. Draco, it's best you speak because you'll start using big words. Anything but big words. Andrew said while reading one of my new books. I gave him a death glare. There's a lot of those, which he returned with a funny one. Funny glare counters death glare. Why, period, did, period, you, period, do, period, that, period, Draco, period, I said to him. My face must have been really red because Andrew started to rub my hand to calm me down, commas place. He always did that when I got angry. Okay. Draco faced me, and when he saw my face, he scooted away as much as he could. I'm sorry, but you were hanging with those silly Weasley twins. That family is nothing but a disgrace to purebloods like us, he finally said, and I looked at him. How dare he! That is not she didn't say that out loud. That's just in her head in caps. I looked at him and then turned away. You all are wondering, why didn't you say anything back, Skylar? Yeah. Thanks for guessing. Well, because I always have a plan, and that plan is to ignore him until he apologizes. Why would... This kid has been... It's been drilled into his head that he is literally better than not non-purebloods, right? So why would he think that that's what he needs to apologize for, ever? You know? Like, at a point, you're just so indoctrinated. It's just... it becomes natural to you. I'm laying down. I'm having a grand old time. I'm on this mic, and we are back in business. The mic is right in front of the computer screen, and I'm pretending that that is not happening. Andrew was still reading, but he heard every single word Draco has said. Let's just say he won't be talking to him either. Let's just say is when you're hinting at something, not literally saying the thing. Why? Stop doing that. Because he also hangs with the Weasley twins. We meet them at the joke shop on Christmas Eve last year, when my family and the Malfoys got together. We met. Don't do that either. Since then, we have been owling each other. Like texting, but with owls? We are now at the manor. Bold italics. I don't know. I headed to the room I always stayed in when I came to the Malfoy Manor. It was beautiful, comma, the view was amazing. Is that it? At all? Okay. After a few minutes of packing, I took a break. Skyla, have you finished packing, sweetheart? Narcissa said. She came into the room and saw me sitting. She came to me and smiled. That's a comma splice. Tired, sweetheart? She said, and I nodded. Yes, ma'am, I said, and she shook her head and laughed. No need to call me ma'am. We've known each other since the day you were born. Call me sissy. Call me heteronormative, cisgendered white woman. White female. I don't know. I'm trying to cobble together a joke from terms. But what I'm getting at is that you shouldn't need to say that this far into your relationship. If you've known each other since the day that that she was born, this would have come up earlier, for sure. She said, and I smiled wide. Okay, I said, and she hugged me. Yeah, this is like a really weirdly one-sided relationship. Narcissa saw me as her daughter because, well, she was the only girl in the family. When I visited, she would always have something planned out. Are you ready for tomorrow? She said. I smiled wide and nodded. Yes, I'm very excited, I said, and she smiled. Stop. Be done. Okay? She was about to leave when she turned around. You should finish packing, darling, she said, and I nodded once more. That could have just not happened, honestly. I went back to packing. I paused for a while to grab a spellbook. I read it and found the perfect spell. I grabbed my wand and did the spell. As soon as I finished my packing, I stared at my wand. I then remembered what Ollivander had said as soon as I got it. Are you not going to tell me what the spell was? Okay. Just like her mother's and, of course, her father. This wand is very powerful, Mrs. Whitelock. What is that? Who's Whitelock? The wand chooses the wizard. This wand is spruce wood, 12 1/4 in length, and a unicorn and phoenix gave its feather. Unicorns don't have feathers. That's why it's so powerful. What about it's so powerful? No apostrophe. But it is very strange for the phoenix that gave its feather to this wand gave two other feathers. I am so upset. I glanced ahead. Mr. Ollivander, what do you mean it's strange? I had asked. He looked at my closer. Not his closer, my closer. And stared. One wand was given to you-know-who. And the other one. A boy by the name of Harry Potter. Thank God! Better at magic than Harry Potter. Linked to Harry Potter. Friends with Harry Potter. This is gonna be fun. He said and I gasped, Mr. Ollivander, does that mean my wand, Harry Potter's wand, and you know whose wand are the same? I asked. He nodded. Okay. I looked at my wand and smiled. It was very interesting how this wand chose me. Mr. Ollivander had said that many people had tried to handle the wand, but it had never obeyed to those people. It had a very beautiful pearl at the very end, and it would glow each time I casted a spell. The light was sometimes blinding. That seems bad if you're trying to do stealth magic. I put my wand near my dresser and continued to read my school books. That is correct, though. If you were, like, learning magic, you would 100% do your schoolwork, because it's learning magic, how to willfully operate the universe in ways that take apparently no effort and relieve you of tremendous burden. You would do that, like, ASAP. I would be buying all the books at the same time and just running right on through them. After I was finishing the last page of my school book, Potions, when Andrew came in. "Sky, dinner is ready," he said, and I nodded. He walked out, but soon came back. I guess he thought I was right behind him. "Skylar," he said once more. "1 minute, Andy. Let me finish editing this page." Editing? All right. I responded, and he came over to me. "You're reading?" "Not my reading. You're reading the school books?" he questioned. I put the book down and looked at him. "Yes," I smiled. We were now exiting my room and going down the stairs in many turns. "Why?" he asked while we walked. I was bored, I said, and shrugged. He gave me once more, a questioning look. This is just monotony. This is just monotony. I said it 3 times, and that means it has to come true. It's a spell now. It already is true. Didn't my mother buy you 2 new books? You dropped the U out of buy. "How do you even do that?" he said, and I nodded. "Yes, but I'm saving those for the train," I said, and we had finally made it to the dining room. "Thank God! Eating!" He shrugged and went to go sit down in his normal chair right next to Draco, and next to Draco was me. On the other side was Sissy and Lucius. As we finished our dinner, Dobby came up to me. "Okay. I can take that, Mistress Everly," he said. I smiled but shook my head. "It's all right, Dobby. I've got it," I said, and Dobby nodded. Like, if you are raised as a noble, essentially a noble in this world, and you are raised explicitly with the fact in mind that house goblins, right? House gnome? I don't remember at all. I don't remember. That they're an inferior race that enjoys working. And you wouldn't, like, be super woke and, like, deny them that. I believe it was made explicit in the books that Dobby is weird and doesn't like working, and the rest of them are just, like, willing slaves, because Rowling didn't want to dive too much into slavery. House elf, right? I think that's it. Whatever. What? I asked. Oh yeah, people are staring. What? I asked, and they just kept staring. If you keep staring, just take a picture. It'll last longer, I sassed them. Andrew looked like he was blushing, and Draco just sneered. Why does Andrew look like he's blushing? That little, huh? What? I don't even know what that's supposed to mean. That's in its own paragraph, too. I have no idea. Andrew smiled at me, and I smiled back. Lots of that. Lots of smiling. He never got to finish since Sissy and Lewis walked in again. Lewis. They looks at us and smiled. More like Sissy smiled. I hate calling her Sissy. I super do. Lucius stared, and I could even see a little glare. I think it's time you 3 went to bed, Lucius said. Sissy's smile faded, and she looked at us. Go on, children. You have yo get up bright and early tomorrow, so you won't miss the train, she said. Me, Andrew, and Draco looked at each other and nodded. No, Andrew, Draco, and I learned that also. We all headed back up the stairs, no one spoke a word. Good night, Draco, Andrew said before Draco entered his room. Good night, Andrew, he responded. He looked at me and smiled. Good night, Evergreen. I don't know what that, like, is supposed to mean. I'm not sure at all, he said, and I glared at him. Andrew frowned and turned to me. Ignore Draco. I don't know why he doesn't like you, Andrew said. I shrugged. I honestly don't know either. Good night, Andy, I said. Good night, Skylar. Is this like that one, like, what was it? It was like a sitcom, and it ended with, like, good night, and, like, between every member of the house. I forgot what that was. It's funny, though. Andrew responded with and went down farther into the hall where his room is. I opened my bedroom door and entered. I sighed. I went over to Nightwing. Nightwing with a K, and it's the name of her owl. My snowy owl that I got for my 11th birthday from my parents. I feed him. I feed him. And I was about to go change into my pajamas when I saw a letter tied on his legs. Both of them must have made flying difficult. I untied it and saw my family's crest on the envelope. I'm giggling. I sat on my bed and opened it. Dear Skylar, your father and I won't be able to see you leave for Hogwarts tomorrow. As it turns out, the ministry needs us to work on a case. We love you deeply. Your brother and sister will come by instead. Ah, right. Your father wants you in Slytherin, and I want you in Gryffindor. From your brother and sister, I have no idea. Oh, okay, I get it. She doesn't know what her brother and sister want. Okay. We just want you to know that no matter what house you're in, not my inn, you're in, we will be proud. With the letter, we have given you an extra little gift for your birthday. It's been in your family for generations. Keep it safe. We love you deeply. Love your mother and father. I reread the letter, tears staining it little by little. They weren't going to say goodbye. They sent a letter. That's the best they can do. I felt heartbroken, but yet angry. I was such a fool to believe they had time for me. Those gosh darn hardworking parents doing their best to provide for their children. At what point, I think that's when you become an adult, is when you start going like, yeah, well, gotta do what you gotta do. Instead of going like, oh, they didn't make time for their daughter. The first time you rewatch The Little Mermaid and you're like, she's such an idiot, that's when you're an adult. At least Nathan and Cleo were watching me leave for Hogwarts. I set the letter aside and grabbed the small black box. I untied the green ribbon and opened the lid. Inside it was a beautiful silver ring with our family's crest and an E for evergreen. I put on the ring. It fit perfectly around my finger. I put the box back on my nightstand and changed into my black, silky, nightgown. I decided to edit the chapter, the author's note says. There are some changes. I hope you enjoy the book. I'll try to update as much as I can through the week. I won't be able to since school gets in your way, turtle. Honestly, this was, like, sort of charming. It wasn't good. Like, for sure. There's way too much, like, OP, like, stuff. You know what I mean? Like, she has a wand that is linked to Harry Potter's wand. I want a fan fiction about a normal kid. Right, who goes to Hogwarts and gets in stupid adventures. I want a fan fiction about the American Hogwarts. What's that like? See, the best part of Harry Potter, far and away, is the world. Because it's, one, super flexible. Two, like, moderately fleshed out. Like, there are some rules, and, like, that's enough, I guess, for fiction. But the books are the problem. The books are just sort of hard to read sometimes because they're like super cliche and a lot of them are just sort of boring. And fan fiction about Harry Potter can be good. I guarantee it. I promise. I've just never seen it happen. And it makes me wonder. It makes me wonder. Perhaps I should write a good Harry Potter fan fiction. Who would know?
Anyway, until next time, bye.